When he was 23 years old, he wrote his 10th album. And you folks in England have the good sense to vote it the best album of all time, and it's called Pet Sounds. And he is the great Brian Wilson.
With Pet Sounds, I tried to make a sketchbook that represented my whole life. And I did.
We're going to do the entire Pet Sounds album now.
I wanted people to hear what I felt inside my soul, because I knew there's so much, I have such a big soul, that I wanted to share it with people.
I understand my collaborator that wrote Pet Sounds with me is here in the audience tonight, Mr. Tony Asher. Can you please put the spotlight on Tony? Tony Asher, ladies and gentlemen.
That was my way of coping with those kind of things that come up in every man's life.
So take off your shoes, sit back, and enjoy about 40 minutes of good music. Okay, now cut number two. Let's slow the beat down a little bit and make a ballad song for you. I know perfectly well I'm not where I should be. And I've been with me. Every time we break, but I can't help how I am when you're not here with me. I try hard to be strong, but sometimes I feel myself. And after all I promised you so faithfully,
your head.
my shoulder. Come close, close your eyes and be still. Don't talk, take my hand and let me hear your heart. Let's not think about tomorrow. And don't talk, put your head on my shoulder. Come close, close your eyes and be still. Don't talk, take my hand and listen to my heart. Listen, listen, listen. Don't talk, put your head on my shoulder. Close, close your eyes and be still. Don't talk, put your head on my shoulder. Come close, close your eyes and be still.
Thank you very much.
Let me hear the loudest you can yell. This is a song that has incredible drums. Where do you hear these drums?
That's when you need someone to help forget about him. I gave you love with a brand new start. That's what you needed the most to set your broken heart free. I know you cried and you felt blue, but when I could, I gave strength to you. I'm waiting for the day love again. I kissed your lips when your face looked sad. It made me think about him and that you still loved him so.
Oh, baby, don't you know?
But pretty soon I make you feel glad that you belong to me, and love began to show. He hurt you then, but that's all. I guess I'm saying you're the only one. I'm waiting for the day when you can love. Go!
those great drums? That's Jimmy Hines on drums. Okay. We're going to do an instrumental. No voices on this one, just instruments. So give it a good listen. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. This next song is about a poem called Wreck of the Sloop John. The Kingston Trio did music to it, then the Beach Boys did their version. It's all about a ship. You come on the Sloop John B, my grandfather and me. I want to go home. So hoist up the John B. sail. See how the mainsail set. Call for the captain ashore. Let me go home. I want to go home. Why don't you let me go home? Yeah, yeah. Well, I feel so broke up. I want go home. The first mate, he got drunk. Now this next song is a song that Paul McCartney told me that it was his favorite tune, but I don't know if it was or not.
Above you, you never need to doubt it. I'll make you so sure about it. And God only knows what I'd be without you. If you should ever leave me, well, life would still go on, believe me. The world could show nothing to me. What good would living do me? God only knows what I'd be without you. We'll be right back. It starts with just a little glance now. Right away you're thinking about romance now. No, you ought to take it slower, but you just can't wait to get to know her. A brand new makes your days go wrong, it makes your night so long. You gotta keep in mind, love is here. Today it's gone, tomorrow it's here and gone so fast. Right now you think that she's perfection. This time is really an exception.
to happen.
what goes wrong. Sometimes
they turned it down, so we put it on this album. It's called Pet Sounds. guys picked up on that, huh? Now that we've made a couple loud noises, we want to slow down the beat quite a bit and do a nice, pretty, sweet song for you.
Where did your long hair go? Where is the girl I used to know? How could you lose that happy glow? Oh, Caroline. Caroline, you break my heart. My heart wanna go and cry. It's so sad to watch a sweet thing die. Oh, Caroline, why? Ever finding you again, things that made me love you so much then, could we ever bring them back once they have gone? Okay.
Can you believe it? Brian Wilson in London, England. Finally. Well, we're real proud of the band that Brian put together, so I'd like to introduce each member to you. Starting with our great drummer, Mr. Jimmy Hines. And his twin brother from Chicago, Illinois, on bass, Mr. Bobby Lizick. the Tasty Brothers. From the Black Sea Surfing Association, Mr. Nikolai Wonder. Our lovely female vocalist from Sherman Oaks, California, Miss Taylor Mills. And her dancing partner on keyboards, vibes, guitar, and vocals, Mr. Scotty Bennett. On keyboards, vibes, vocals, and everything else over there, Mr. Darian Sahanaja. Guitar, theremin, French horn, trumpet, and vocals, Mr. Proben Gregory. And from the Wonderments on percussion and vocals and guitar, Mr. Mikey D'Amico. On saxophone, flutes, harmonicas, all around great guy, Mr. Paul Von Mertens.
And that's Jeffrey Foskett on fabulous vocals and guitar.
Jeffrey Foskett.
Thank you. Did I leave anybody out? Oh yeah, there's one more guy. When he was 23 years old, he was giving us his 10th album. Think about that, 23, he was doing his 10th album. It was called Pet Sounds. The great Brian Wilson.
Okay. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Okay. You all drove here to pick up some good vibes, right? Well, you got some good vibrations coming. I love the colorful clothes she wears and the way the sunlight plays upon her hair. I hear the sound of a gentle word on the wind that lifts her perfume through the air. I'm picking up her vibration. She's giving me the excitation. I'm picking up her vibration. Softly smile, I know she must be calm. When I look in her eyes, she goes with me to a blossom world. I'm picking up the vibration.
I'm picking up good.
The inspiration for Pet Sounds was Rubber Soul. That was the one that got me going. My friend goes, I want you to listen to this album by the Beatles. And I got so blown out that I went to the piano and started writing songs, started making melodies. I wanted to try to top it. I felt competitive with the Beatles. You know, it's a funny thing, it's funny. But I felt competitive with them. After the Beatles heard Pet Sounds, they wanted to make a greater album, so they did Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. And it was a very, very, very great album. Right up there with Pet Sounds, and it was like really good. And then we came out with Blues Vibrations, and they came out with Penny Lane and all those songs, you know. The Beatles and the Beach Boys were chasing each other up a spiral. It's like the never-ending spiral.
Thank you.
did six shows in London. The audience reacted very, very positively. I really got a good reaction out of it. It was quite amazing. There's lovingness in the music that people can relate to the love, regardless if you're 2 years old or you're 92 years old. I'm very proud of myself for people who tell me that it's the greatest album of all time. To me, the greatest album of all time is the Phil Spector Christmas album. That's my personal favorite.
Brian Wilson used to come around once in a while to the Spector sessions.
As an observer, and because I liked the way he sat at the piano, I liked the way he talked, I liked his voice, I liked his face, I liked the way he looked. I liked him. What can I tell you?
We didn't really know who he was.
I was a frustrated artist and producer that wanted to do something great like Spector, you know? I wanted to do something good like Phil Spector.
Philip had his wall of sound. Every producer in town used to come by to peek in because they knew that the word was like wildfire. Phil Spector's recording, usually Friday nights.
He used to use a bunch of musicians that were really, really ahead of their time, really good players. So I used them for Pet Sounds.
They were trying to learn what the magic dust Phil Spector was sprinkling on records.
I wanted to take the wall of sound and do my own thing with it and try a new wall of sound.
When Brian was signed by Capitol, he wanted the Wrecking Crew guys. And that's how I got involved.
Al Blaine, Carol Kay, Ray Pullman, Billy Pittman, Jay Migliore, Steve Douglas, Frankie Capp, Tommy Morgan, Billy Strange, and Glenn Campbell, yeah, Larry Nettle, Don Randy. I said to him, I want this to be as good as Phil Spector's records. And they all started laughing, you know. And I said, no, I'm serious. I want it to be as good as Phil Spector.
Well, the first time I saw Brian, he was a very young man. But something was different, though, about him, because I noticed that everybody respected him a lot. And so word got out among us studio musicians, because we talk about the people that we worked for. First of all, most of the rock and rollers are very nice that we worked for, but we always had to invent lines for them. But with Brian, no, he brought in his own music.
See, I would write the music on paper, music paper. And I go in and I say, here's your paper, here's your paper, here's your paper, here's your paper, here's your paper. And they all read the notes on the paper together.
We respected that whole idea that he had, you know. We didn't try to destroy it. We were the band and he was the leader.
Brian was firm about what he wanted. He was able to express himself and let you know what you should do. And he was always pretty cool in the studio.
Frankie Capp had a bag of tricks, like you wouldn't have 20 different kinds of percussive instruments.
Tambourine, maracas, wood blocks, temple blocks, triangles, cowbell, all kinds of hand percussion, anything that would make a sound.
So we try one thing, we didn't like it.
Vibraphone, marimba.
Try another thing.
Timpani, orchestra bells, which were kind of glockenspiel, orchestra bells is what they really were.
After about 8 or 9 tries, we finally got, oh, there's the one. That's the one we want.
Brian wanted the take to be exactly right, and if it was a half hour or an hour over, or if it took another total session, it didn't matter. He would go until he got what he wanted. And that's why he got good tracks and hit songs.
He was very creative and very investigative.
Certain musicians can read notes. They can actually read fly shit off of paper. That's how well they read. And that's Tommy Morgan.
I think the way I originally got involved with Brian Wilson was through Hal Blaine. And I guess there was need of harmonica. Not everybody needs harmonica. My career has been based on people thinking they need harmonica.
Tommy Morgan was the best harmonica player I ever worked with. I could not believe his playing. It was just really good.
I like people who know what they want. I like people who have prepared for things. I like them that are in control of what they're doing and have ideas that you can bounce off. Brian was excellent. How did Brian give me the information? Sometimes play the piano, sometimes sing in my ear, but the communication was there. It was very positive communication.
Brian, when he was playing the organ, he'd be explaining the same time he was playing, because we weren't recording yet, and he said, I'm gonna, you know, I'll be moving around here, and I would play something, and he would, and I would look over there, and he has some good sized hands too, so he, and he knew how to pull the what they call the feet, the bars on the organ, on the B3, and I would be playing something, and he said, oh, that, yeah, stay with that, you know, and then you'd work off each other, you know, and that was made it so much fun.
There's never been a Don Randy. He played for Phil Spector's records. I think he was on Be My Baby. I'm not sure, but I think he was, Don Randy. The most versatile, hard-rocking, swinging, rock and roll piano player that ever lived. Phil Spector would say, try this, and he tried before Phil could answer, ask him the question, he'd already have the notes. That quick.
I was doing most of Phil's dates, and the word got out I was doing that and other things, and Brian called me.
And of course, at that time, remember that we were adults, maybe approaching 30, 31 years old, and these kids were 16, 17-year-old kids singing about surfing. And what the heck did we know about surfing? So in the beginning, this was very infantile music to us. So when Brian all of a sudden started singing these falsetto things, we thought, what is this? What is he doing? I mean, it was impossible. But this is a paycheck, and we were in there to do our best that we could, and we did. And of course, it seems like within weeks, we were hearing it all over the radio.
Hal Blaine was the funniest guy I've ever met. He was the glue that kept the session together. He would crack jokes so much he'd get the guys and musicians in stitches.
You know the difference between an oboe and an English horn? An oboe takes longer to burn. But meanwhile...
And he wouldn't listen to me. He'd still keep going. And I go, Hal, stop joking around.
Brian never wanted to be interrupted when he was listening to something, because the wheels were clicking constantly. It never stopped. He was meshing, he was putting together his soul. You know, it's what he loved and what he wanted and what he wanted to be perfect. And that's how he worked. That's all there was to it. And we all quickly appreciated that.
He was focused into the music. The reason why we play music in the first place is we had that very same focus to play music. It was our life, it was our breath. To him, music was his life and his breath, and we understood that.
With Pet Sounds, I wanted to write some songs that reflected how I really felt, about life. Something that I felt in my soul, rather than just car songs, surf songs, you know. Something more introspective, like taking a good look at yourself, see how you feel, and then see what you should do to improve yourself. That was my way of coping with those kind of things that come up in every man's life. I tried to make it the most artistic, loving album ever made, and it was one of the best.
When we first began to work, Brian said, I want to do something unlike anything the Beach Boys have ever done before, so don't think in terms of past Beach Boys songs.
A friend of mine knew Tony, and he said, if I needed a collaborator, Tony was very good at words because he was worked at an advertising agency.
And I got this call, and voice on the other end said, this is Brian Wilson.
He came over and we hit it off just like that. We started writing songs right away.
Was there an intimidation factor on your part?
I don't know, maybe he was intimidated, ask him.
He was just a very cool person with a cool attitude, the right kind of attitude for me to work with. He wasn't egotistical. He wasn't an outgoing and braggadocio kind of person. He's like a cool, laid-back kind of person.
Essentially, it was a collaborative experience, which is to say that Brian was composing melodies at the same time that I was composing lyrics, and we would stand next. He'd be sitting at the piano, and I'd be standing with a legal pad writing lyrics as they came to me.
I would write part of a melody, he'd write part of a lyric, then I'd write more melody, he'd write more lyric. Once in a while, I'd have a whole melody written for him to write a lyric, but usually it was like, little melody, little words, little melody, little words, you know, like that.
He told me that the real problem was that he was, I think they were something like a year late with the album, or many months late with the album, and needed to turn out a lot of songs in a short period of time, and everybody that he had written with before was out of the country. The boys were in Japan, I think.
I told the boys that I wanted to get off the road in 1965. I told them I want to write some songs while you're on tour, and when you come back, we'll record them. So they agreed. I said, well, Mike, I'm running with another collaborator. He goes, what?
another collaborator. He says, I thought I was your collaborator. I said, well, for this one album, Tony Asher's my collaborator. And he understood. So Tony and I did Pet Sounds. And when they got back, the tracks were all ready for them, all ready to go. All they had to do is go in and learn their parts. And that was that. Tony was a little more meticulous. Mike was real spontaneous, you know.
Before, every time we would meet to write, we'd spend at least an hour just sitting in the living room, not even next to the piano, talking about our life experiences, mostly dating, women, love affairs, heartbreak, that kind of stuff. And that would put us in a certain mood, and then based upon that mood, we'd write a song of a certain kind. A perfect example probably is Caroline No, where we talked about how sad it is to see a girl after you have had this crush on her, and you see her several years later, and she's kind of grown up and gotten hardened by the world and so forth. And then we sat down and wrote that song.
I wrote it for Carol. I was in love with her in high school, and as soon as high school was out, I went to the piano and played a Four Freshmen song. And I was thinking about her and I started crying because I realized I'd never be able to have her. So later on when Tony and I got together, I thought, Carol Ein, for Carol. So I wrote it for Carol.
I had heard it as Carol I Know, Carol comma I Know, and Brian was hearing it as Caroline No. That only lasted for a couple of minutes because we decided what it was going to be, but it, that's kind of an interesting little play on words. And because I don't think I would have written the words Caroline No. It's not a phrase that I would ever use, but it's so poignant, you know, a phrase to use. Just to say no, you know, like, no, no, don't do that, you know. And it really adds so much to that song, so. I think it was a great improvement, as it turns out.
Caroline No, my dad told me to put a speed up on the tape machine, and speed it up about a half a note. And he said, it'll sound sweeter. I said, Dad, I can't do that. He goes, son, look, trust me, try it. You'll love it. I tried it, and it worked. I loved it. I asked Capitol Records to put Caroline No out as a single under the name Brian Wilson because I wanted to promote my name. And they did, and the song didn't make it. The darn thing didn't make it, you know?
If it had, do you think it might have marked the end of the Beach Boys?
Oh, no. If it was a hit, I might have released another one, but I'm glad it didn't because I'm glad the Beach Boys kept going. Wouldn't It Be Nice is one of the happiest songs I ever wrote. A very happy song.
Brian just loved the idea of you know, wouldn't it be nice to be a young couple that could do whatever you wanted to do and want to be great when we can.
Tony and I wrote that song for people, for young people who know what it's like to fall in love and be happy and spend the day together and all that, you know. We wanted people to relate to those lyrics.
Wouldn't it be nice, Brian played me a little part of the melody, but he hadn't finished it. And so periodically I'd ask him about that and I'd say, you know, how's that song coming? Or he'd say, let's work on something else. What do you want to work on? I'd say, what about that song played me the other day? Oh, I haven't finished that yet. So that continued. And eventually he said to me, okay, now I'm finished. I can play it to you. So he did. He played me the whole thing all the way through, no lyric. Then we began to compose that. I mean, I began to write a lyric to it. But because he had completely finished the melody at that point, all he focused on for the first time in our collaboration was my lyric. And he was focusing on absolutely every syllable. And it was terribly difficult for me to write. As you know, there are lots of syllables and lots of words in that lyric because it has so many notes. And about 5 minutes into the process, I said, this is not going to work, because in the past when we wrote together, he had something else to concentrate on, which was writing the melody. But in this case, there was nothing else for him to do. His work was done. So I said, why don't you just play this into a cassette recorder and I'll take it home and write it. And when I brought it back, it was, again, one of those situations where he listened to it and said, it's great.
The words, the lyrics by Tony were really exceptionally good, you know, on that one.
On Wouldn't It Be Nice, Brian wanted to beef up the end of the phrase, so he had me play a ba-bum, ba-bum on the timpani to kind of help beef up what Hal was doing, because Hal was playing a figure there too.
With Hal, sometimes he would be a little headstrong and he wanted to play it his way. So I had a couple arguments with him.
I've heard other musicians talk about his charts. I never saw a chart. We had chord sheets, you know, that started here and ended here, and maybe a stop in between, and the rest of it was do what you feel.
on Wouldn't It Be Nice, I said, look, I'm really looking for more of a boom instead of a boom, boom, you know. And he goes, well, what's wrong with this? Boom, boom. I said, you're not getting the beat. It's boom, boom, not boom, boom. And he goes, oh, I see, I see. That's how it would work.
Brian was a beautiful young man who had a very strong feeling for music. We sensed the artist in him, and we knew that he was self-taught, but there was something burning in him to create great things. And when his music got better and better as far as his arranging and the kind of tunes that he wrote and like that, we saw a genius explode.
With Pet Sounds, I wanted people to hear what I felt inside my soul, because I knew there's so much, I have such a big soul that I wanted to share it with people.
Well, when I first started working on the album with Brian, he was in a very creative, very productive sort of mood, and while I'm sure he felt pressure from Capitol, it didn't seem like a panicky kind of situation at all. And it seemed to work very well. I mean, it just flowed. We sort of buoyed each other up, and I mean, he was always very supportive and complimentary about what I was doing, and I was genuinely just knocked out by the things he was doing. So it was fun. We just sat and said, wow, that's great, try this, you know, do that.
We were on all eight cylinders. We really kind of kicked butt together, you know. It was really great. I'd been hearing thoughts and things in my head, and finally I got it out to Tony. I got across to Tony a feeling, and he got a feeling back across to me. It was really amazing.
When you write with someone at the piano, you always wonder, if you're a lyricist, you always wonder what they're really hearing in their head, because what they play on the piano is limited by how well they can duplicate what they're hearing in their head. And what I didn't know, of course, was what kinds of things Brian was hearing. That was one of the things that was so exciting about hearing the final mixes and the final recordings, because all of these string, flute, other instrument things, I never heard because they were in Brian's head, but I wasn't privy to that.
We used to go and do these sessions. We never heard finished product. We made a track, and one night you're driving home from the studio, and you turn, and all of a sudden, you hear the record that you did a few weeks ago. And my God, it's magnificent.
What was so interesting when we were laying down the tracks, you'd see his eyes going, and you'd look in, and he'd be talking to you, and he was hearing the structure of where the vocals were going to be. See, now, we didn't know where that was going to end up. He knew.
We never knew the song, but when we did hear it on the radio or whenever, and we said, yeah, that's what we did, it really made it, because Brian pulled it all together with his song and his vocals.
The only thing that I regret is that I never was there when he did the vocals. I would have loved to watch them do that.
I would take the Beach Boys in the studio, and here's what we'd do. I would take one song at a time. Say, guys, I want to do God Only Knows today. I would say, Carl, here's your part. I want you to do this. I want you to do ba, 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 ba. And he would sing that. And Mike, ba, ba, ba. Like that. He would sing his part. And Al, same thing. He had to stand on a box. He was so short. He had to stand up on a box to sing on the microphone with. And Dennis, of course. Of course he was singing. Dennis would sing, yeah. They learn it quick. They're real quick learners. Real fast. Sometimes two songs per day, but mostly just one. But basically, I didn't want to overwork their voices. You know, I wanted their voices to be in shape.
I always felt the best parts were the vocals anyway. We were the underscore. We laid it down, and thank God we did. It was fun for us, and we knew Brian was going to take this someplace that nobody expected.
With the tune, God Only Knows, it was a very sad song, I felt. You know, you could feel the emotion in it. But I think then, too, I think about two or three of us, I mean, we were going through the breakup of our marriages or something like that. So it was kind of added to that, you know.
God Only Knows took me and Tony about an hour to write. It came very fast. It came just like that. And he and I were both astonished with it. We said, we have a classic song on our hands here.
And I almost got tears. I mean, it was like a beautiful tune that we had written together, you know.
I never gave any thought to who would actually, you know, sing lead on what song. The only exception to that I recall is that when we were writing God Only Knows, I can remember Brian at some point saying, Carl's going to sing this and it's going to be fantastic.
I said, you know, this would be really good for Carl. He goes, you're right, it would be good for Carl. I said, no, maybe I should do it. He goes, no, Carl. So we taught it to Carl and he went in there and knocked it out.
If you should ever leave me, life will still go on, pity me. The world could show nothing to me. So what good would living do me? God only knows what I'd be without you.
It's my favorite Carl vocal of all the vocals, even better than Darlin'.
Let me tell you something about God Only Knows. We didn't know the title of that. So when we were playing it, you knew it was kind of a very special song, just the way it's chorded. From nothing else, you're saying, oh my God, this is absolutely beautiful. And then when you hear the lyric, oh my God, I mean, it was priceless. Just wonderful.
Now this next song is a song that Paul McCartney told me that it was his favorite tune, but I don't know if it was or not. The inspiration for Pet Sounds was Rubber Soul. That was the one that got me going. November of 65, at my house in Beverly Hills, my friend goes, I want you to listen to this album by the Beatles. And I got so blown out that I went to the piano and started writing songs, started making melodies. I wanted to try to top it. I felt competitive with the Beatles. You know, it's a funny thing, it's funny. But I felt competitive with them.
When we were beginning to work on Pet Sounds, Brian and I both talked about Rubber Soul and said, let's try to do that. Let's try to put the bar up there where this album had put it, you know.
After the Beatles heard Pet Sounds, they wanted to make a greater album, so they did Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. And it was a very, very, very great album, right up there with Pet Sounds, and it was, like, really good.
The Beatles, they were completely hooked on Pet Sounds. I was told that personally by John Lennon, by George Harrison.
And then we came out with Blues Vibrations, and they came out with Penny Lane and all those songs, you know. The Beatles and the Beach Boys were chasing each other up a spiral. It's like the never-ending spiral.
We expected every date that we did from him to be a huge hit because he was producing more and more. He was very focused and very sure about his music. And the music was great. He'd sit down and play the tune so that we got the idea of the tune. And then he'd go in the booth and he would give us orders from the booth.
There would be a number of guitars, sometimes two, three, maybe even four. Barney Kessel sometimes, Glenn Campbell. And there was always drums, bass, an organ and piano, or organ or piano. Either Brian would play one, I would play something else, or sometimes he would just stay in the studio and use two of us. In those days, Larry Nechtel, I think, did some. I did a lot of them. There were a number of pianists that he could have used through that time. Everybody was in the same room, and eye contact was there, and it was wonderful because, you know, in those days, if it felt really good, Brian was happy also. It wasn't just how it sounded. It had to feel good, too.
We had that beautiful spot inside of his soul that we worked with, and it was back and forth, and he knew that we could play, and we knew that he could write, and so there was a wedding of us all. Age didn't matter. He could write, and he was a good person to us because he knew he respected us, and when you have that, that's the greatest type of person to work for it.
We just wanted to make fun records that felt good. And that's what we did every time we went in to work with Brian.
Okay, here's a story about Sloop John B. Al Jardine came to me. He said, would you like to try to do Sloop John B in a Beach Boy style? And he played the Kingston Trio's version. And I took down the chords of the song, and I went into my piano room and wrote an arrangement of it. Just like that. I said, I love it, Al, I love it. He goes, I can't wait to hear it. And he goes in the studio and goes, Brian, you've done it again, you've done it again.
Brian did everything with a sense of humor. He was marvelous. The joking around was just great. And you knew that something was going to happen that was going to be nothing but greatness.
With Pet Sounds, I tried to make a sketchbook that represented my whole life. And I did.
he was learning as he was going too. You know, he was trying this sound and that sound, and he had the freedom to do that, and we understood that.
Carol Kay played with a pick, right? So she got the top, the click sound of the bass, and the boom sound of the bass at the same time. So I gave her the click boom sound.
I usually played with a lot of bottom on my bass. For instance, on some things, let's see. Here's what I would say was my normal sound. See, and so then he wanted more high end along with the bottom, so it was more like this.
Thought bass lines, and that's obvious. A good classical trained musician thinks bass lines as well. Brian thought bass lines, albeit he was a bass player and played piano and that sort of thing, but the bass was a very important part of his rhythm structures.
A lot of it was jazz. This is jazz. That's a walking line. That's a good jazz walking line. But then he got off in symphony. He put the bass in the right hand part, see, which was more classical in nature, and it still had a groove. Brian has a great groove. I watched him play bass, and he's got a terrific groove. He gets up there and he makes the whole band sound good. It didn't groove until he got up there and started playing. All of a sudden, the groove just fell right in. See, he might not have his hand just right or something, but he plays. You know, he has a groove. So all of his records groove too. He imparted that groove to us. And it was a good feeling. So when you've got the sounds and you got the groove, you have a great record.
Well, it's about people who don't want to express themselves to other people. They keep to their own self. They're afraid to be with people and say, here's how I feel, this is what I went through, you know. It's just about that kind of thing. It's no big deal, no big song.
All of the rhythm parts, doubling the bass line in that, were dictated by Brian. And so those were very specific, which Brian controlled, and I played exactly what he wanted. When it came to the solo, then I was given a little bit of freedom, which was an interesting thing, because it's the first time I ever had a solo on one of Brian's albums. And to my mind, the first time that the bass harmonica had been used as a solo instrument in a rock record. And so I improvised that part. Brian was also very interesting from the standpoint of when he was finding out what bass harmonica could do. He knew what he wanted, but if it ran off the end of the instrument or something, he was quick to make an adjustment and make a change, or if it was impossible to play, very awkward, something like that, then he would make a change. He didn't come in with 29 notes that he wanted each note that way. He wanted his 29 notes. You could only do 25 of them. Well, he would change the other four, and he could make a decision quickly.
I wasn't really a slave driver. I just, you know, told people what to do.
If he barked at us, that was great, because we knew he knew what he wanted. You don't want anybody nice. You want to get it done.
You Still Believe in Me was the first thing I wrote. Brian already had a track for that. He didn't ever play me the original lyric. It was recorded, I guess, with a lyric in my childhood. He picked out the melody on the piano, which was then recorded over that track, and I went home and wrote the lyric to that melody.
It reminds me of a little child, you know, the child in me. I know perfectly well. You know, that's just the kid in me wanted to come out and play.
But essentially he said, yeah, that's great, let's do another tune. You know, that was pretty much it, which was quite amazing to me.
I was trying to capture the innocence of childhood, yeah, the best I could, you know. So was Tony. He tried to get the lyrics to inspire the little kids.
The little horn that you hear honking at the end of You Still Believe in Me was actually put on in the recording session that was done for In My Childhood. And the idea behind that was that apparently at the end, there's a bicycle bell as well, I think, although I don't know if you can hear it. And it was just all the sounds of a person's childhood that Brian added. And it wasn't possible to get that out because they'd been mixed in with the track. Brian and I were in the studio with nobody else except Chuck Britz, I think, the engineer. Brian decided he wanted to have those strings plucked. So I said to Brian, you sit at the keyboard and push down the notes and hold down the pedals, and I'll pluck the strings because I know I can do that, you know. But of course, when you look inside the piano, it's much more difficult than you think because there are three strings for every note and so forth. So of course, I didn't get it right, and then he finally lost patience and said, you sit at the piano and I'll pluck the strings. Of course, he wasn't any better at it than I was, you know. And it took us the longest time to get that, just that simple little phrase. It really took like, I don't know, 45 minutes or something.
I'm picking up the vibration.
I remember one day we were together, Brian and I, and he began playing a rhythmic feel on the piano and said, I really like this feel, don't you? And I said, yeah. He told a story about his mother and the dog. Maybe everybody knows that story.
When I was an 11-year-old kid, this dog was barking at us, right? She goes, a dog that barks at us may not bark at somebody else because he picks vibrations up from us. But 11 years later, I said to myself, dogs barking at people because they pick up vibrations. And I sat at the piano and went, vibrations, vibrations, you know, fooled around. Finally, I got a little bump, 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 bump beat. And Mike Love came over to my house and he goes, how's this? I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the XIT. I said, that sounds great.
Took a long, long time to do that song.
There were 18 sessions for Good Vibrations.
Long.
In five different studios.
It's like, oh, here we go again.
It cost us $16,000 to make.
I had not a clue.
Over a period of about 2 months.
Some days we would come in and we would play for 3, 4, 5 minutes, 10 minutes tops. Brian would say, thank you, gentlemen. And they would be gone.
When he asked me to keep doing this part over and over again, all I was doing was holding a low note. I think it was a low B flat, and it was on the organ, on the Hammond B3. And it was for him to have the basis for that unbelievable modern chord that they do. And it's just amazing because I kept doing it over and over. I said, what chord is he going to be putting against this thing? I'm playing one note, you know, so I didn't know the chord. I knew it was the bottom part of it. And we kept doing it over and over and over. And I had worked all that morning and the night before. I can't remember for who we were working on another project, I think with Jack Nitzsche and somebody. Mm-hmm. And I was a little tired when I got there, and now we kept going on hour after hour over this one thing. So this is the God's honest truth. At one point, I got a pillow and I put it on the low B flat that I just kept holding it, and he kept stopping and starting, going back and forth, and I laid down and I actually took a nap for 15 minutes. I was fast asleep while playing the note with my head. It was just like, oh, a low decibel, you know. And then finally they said, I think we got it, you know. Oh, great. You know, thank God, you know, let's get to some action here.
You start off with a blank piece of paper and then wait for Brian to come around. And many times you'd leave the room for a couple hours. And when the session start? 5? How long you been in the studio? Haven't made it yet, but we're waiting. And we'll get there.
And we continued. Every time we'd go in, sometimes we'd work for hours and hours and hours just to get the feel of this doom, doom. And we never knew what the heck we were doing.
On Good Vibrations, we would go from one studio to another because they had the instruments that I needed at those studios. So we'd go to the studio, use the piano, thanks guys, we're done. Take the tapes over to RCA, put the cello on, get the theremin on, take the tapes over, get the bass over at Western, the bass sound that I like, and then put the tambourine on at CBS, and you've got Good Vibrations.
How did the cello happen?
Well, actually, here's what happened. We got to CBS, and Carl said, you know what sounds good on this is a cello. I said, what do you mean? He goes, well, a cello. I haven't played him on a cello. And all of a sudden, I got this diddly, 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 diddly idea for him. And he put it on tape, and it went, glued the record. It put the record on the map. It was like, perfect.
Brian wasn't afraid to try anything. You know, If there was a sound that he wanted, whether he pick up a stick and hit a string with it, or have me play the inside of the piano, I thought that one of the most brilliant ideas on a rock and roll record ever was a theremin. Who did that? No one.
That eerie sounding theremin? Whew.
Had you ever heard one before?
Yeah, I had. My mom and dad knew I had a friend who had a theremin where you put your hand near this bulb, and if you pull your hand away, the sound gets higher. And you push your hand down toward the bowl, it gets lower. So you can go, like that.
Actually, I did know a theremin player was coming in, and I said, uh-oh.
Theremin was played by a guy named Paul Tanner. I said, try. And it worked.
My God, it was just a piece of one of the great moments of rock and roll.
And with the key changes, with the time changes, it was like a masterpiece. It was like a symphony. It's unbelievable that Brian, this young kid, could come along and do harmonies that were never done.
His stuff was powerful. It was a lot more powerful than the Spector days. I mean, the wall of sound kind of stopped, and he didn't go on with something else. Brian would always change the ideas.
I felt like I was trying to pour something out of like I was a little teapot that I wanted to pour water out of. I felt like a little teapot.
I want to thank you, Brian, for being such a consummate musician and creating such happy, good music.
Brian, you're incredible. You always will be, and you're a very important part of my life. And I love you.
I'm quite sure that he knows I adore him and really wish him only the best. It's been a huge part of my life, and it'll never go away. I mean, I'm associated with it, and I'm so grateful for that.
I miss making records with you. I know you're out there with some great guys, and I think it's wonderful. And all I can say is, you know, we say right on. Just keep it up. Keep those wonderful things happening. But meanwhile, these two guys walked into a bar.
My shoulder, come
stars above you. You never need to doubt it. I'll make you so sure about it. If you should ever leave me, though life would still go on, believe me, the world could show nothing to me. So what good would living do me? God only knows what I'd be without you. Every time I get the inspiration to go change things around, no one wants to help me look for places where new things might be found. Where can I turn when my fair weather friends come out? What's it all about? Each time things start to happen again,
Bruce, hold it. Bruce.
We have a little top 40 sound for this thing.
Hi there, everyone listening to the Kirby Scott Show on WCAO. This is Mike Love, and on behalf of the other Beach Boys, I'd like to have you give a listen to Brian Wilson's new solo, Caroline No.
times together we've been spending. I wish that every kiss was never ending. But wouldn't it be nice? Baby, if we think and wish and hope and pray it might come true. You know, it seems the more we talk about it, it only makes it worse to live.